Hi, this is Yanis. It's been quite a while since we worked together from the first semester. I hope you are doing well. I hope you are safe. Unfortunately, due to COVID, we will not have the opportunity to see each other and work together from the same room, but thanks to Francesca Cuomo, Professor Cuomo, we have the opportunity to work together once again, which for me is really a pleasure. So today we are gonna talk about lightweight messaging protocol, MQTT. The course today's lecture is organized in three parts. Initially, we are gonna look into MQTT and the reason why MQTT is so important and how we can use it. And then we are gonna check out some services provided by Amazon under the AWS IoT Foundation and how essentially MQTT plays a central role in order to bring data generated by sensors within smart environments to the cloud and then essentially use the data in order to carry out certain data analytics in order to do all the analysis that we want to do, the visualization and so on. And then in the third part, I will present a hands-on example using MQTT based on Python and also based on some services of the AWS IoT Foundation. So this is more or less the overview for today, and with no further delay, let's start. So here, let's look into an example of a smart environment. This is one of the, let's say, well-studied use case, that of a smart home. Essentially, the benefits of the smart home is that we have a confined area, we have limited number of users, and also the number of devices is limited. So this is why it's a good starting point in order to examine how we can use, how we can develop applications for smart environments. So here essentially we have an assortment of sensors deployed throughout the home, different kind of smart objects, like for example the smart TV, which provides rich media content, maybe connecting to different online services like Netflix, Disney Plus and so on. Then of course we have various smart lights, smart bulbs and so on, like for example Philips Hue. So here now if let's say the smart TV is connected using a Wi-Fi network or even an Ethernet cable, the smart lights now are using a different technology to establish a network. Typically this is a Zigbee network, or there are also some products that are using Wi-Fi, and more recently we also have some bulbs that are using Bluetooth mesh networking. I think you worked on this during the previous lectures. Then there are also some other sensors that we can install throughout the house. For example, we have sensors that monitor our sleep hygiene, the duration of our sleep, the temperature, our heartbeat while we are sleeping. For example, we have the WeThings Aura product that is monitoring continuously during the night or in general whenever we sleep, and then using the Wi-Fi network transmits the data to the cloud services for further analysis. Then we might have some kind of a smart scale which again measures our body weight, our body composition, and then via Wi-Fi transmits all this data to the cloud. So there's different kind of services available here in the kitchen, in the sofa, and of course in the same environment we also have our smartphone, our wearable sensors, our tablets, and all these things constitute this smart home environment. So clearly here from a data science point of view, it is really important to be able to collect the data from all these different kind of devices, so that then we can carry out different kinds of analysis in order to examine certain aspects of the living in the house, understand the context of the users, provide suggestions for improvements, and so on and so forth. So there are many different scenarios here, improving the life quality, helping people staying fit, looking into the education, security, and so on and so forth. I think it's easy to see how the combination of data coming from all these different kinds of objects, and of course with data available on the cloud, provides many different possibilities for the analysis of the data. Now, of course, this is one possibility. I want to just present another example here. We move to a completely different environment. This is an outdoor environment. This is the future farm, or the farm of the future. We have different names here, or a smart farm if you wish. So indeed, this is an outdoor environment, and here we have different elements that we want to monitor. We do have a building, so again, there are sensors similar to those that we saw in the previous example of the smart home, but of course here to a larger extent. So again, we can have some smart objects that control the lighting or monitor indoor conditions for the storage of the produce or the ventilation of the air, the usage of electricity and water. So here there are some similarities in the fact that, of course, within a farm we also have buildings, but clearly now we have other sensors, for example, the sensors related to the livestock. We have sensors attached, in these examples, to cows, so that they can monitor the health of the animals, they can monitor the well-being, and then, of course, they can send alerts to the network whenever a cow, for example, goes into labor or develops an infection. And of course, this could essentially create problems to the yield or to the overall health of the herd. So now the sensors here are attached maybe to the collar of the cow, and obviously we need to have a different networking technology in relation to those that we use indoors, in indoor environments. So, for example, here we might completely avoid transmitting the data continuously. We could store the data on the collar of the cow using a kind of a memory, and then when the cow returns to the main building using some wireless connection, for example a Bluetooth or a Zigbee, then we can offload all this data to the main part of the system, or we could use a different kind of technology where we are using long distance connectivity like LP1. I'm not sure if you have already covered this kind of technologies, but they are really, let's say, on the other side of the spectrum of Bluetooth. So instead of having short-range connectivity, we now have long-range connectivity that it could go up to kilometers, but it's really narrow band. So we have the possibility to transmit a few bytes, let's say, every hour. Which, of course, in the case of monitoring cows, is more than enough. Then there is a completely different type of items, that objects that we want to monitor, the tractors. And here, of course, we are entering into the smart vehicles category of objects. Here, of course, we have a huge number of sensors that are monitoring the engine of the truck. They are monitoring different aspects. They are monitoring the actual location of the trucks. Here, for example, in the United States, John Deere trucks offer many kinds of information related to even the progress in terms of collecting crops, in terms of evaluating also the soil while the truck is moving. So here, there are, just by examining the smart tractor, there are many, many benefits, many, many applications that can come out by analyzing the data collected from the different endpoints. And again here, given the fact that the tractor is essentially, due to the engine, we have enough energy to power all our sensors, we can also provide a much more stable connectivity using some kind of a 4G or 5G network that continuously transmits data to the main part of the network, and then we can also have some kind of real monitoring of the track. And as a matter of fact, this is also the case of John Deere, where the farmer can also use the smartphone to remotely monitor the state of the tractor and the progress of the work done. So this is clearly a completely different kind of mobile objects. And then moving to more research directions here, the products are not, let's say, into the market. We have the so-called agribots, robots that are carrying out particular operations in the field. Here, Bosch has many different prototypes developed that can be used for different kind of crops. Some of them are also essentially tried out in large scale. We have really mature pilots, for example, collecting specific kinds of crops like vines, like olives, like carrots, for example. So here we have a completely automated robot, or we could even have a group, a fleet of such kind of agribots that, of course, need to coordinate, need to have a continuous connection with each other in order to carry out, let's say, a synchronized movement within the field. And of course, while, for example, carrying out a specific task like the fertilizing or like collecting the crops, they are also collecting specific sensor values, which then, of course, are important for us to analyze and examine. So this, again, is yet another kind of group of objects that have different networking requirements than the previous ones that we just discussed. And of course, we should not essentially ignore all this effort that takes place with drones. These objects have completely different requirements in terms of motion control and navigation. Maybe here they are operated remotely by a human, so we need to have a continuous connection with low latency, where, for example, 5G could be really, really useful, or we could have a different kind of a network, which then allows us to have a quick control over the drone. And at the same time, we need to have certain cameras that not only assists us in controlling and navigating the drone, but actually help us carry out specific tasks, like, for example, thermal cameras in order to monitor our livestock, or other kind of cameras that allow us to take close pictures of the crops in order to analyze the crops. And of course, we also have sensors that monitor the actual operation of the drones, like the battery status and so on. And all this data, all this telemetry is important in order to carry out, let's say, optimize the overall performance of the drones. Now, all the data collected from these different kind of use cases, of course, need to be analyzed, need to be examined, reports need to be made, and then at the end, they are provided to the farmer, where essentially either from the office or remotely, a collaborator, let's say a chemist or a doctor, is checking out specific aspects of this data in order to help the overall operation of the farm. So we see here that we have two different kind of environments, one indoor environment, one environment which is really limited. We have a very specific number of users, versus an outdoor environment where, of course, there are different requirements. We have long distance, long distances, and we need to rely on batteries. However, there are certain similarities between the two, let's say, diverse scenarios. Of course, one important similarity here is the fact that we have there is no single network that allow us to interconnect all these devices. We have to use different networking technologies, and of course we don't have a single point of accessing the data. We have different users with different needs, so we have to have a multifaceted approach in examining the data, in visualizing the data, depending on the needs and the wants of the users. And for example, regarding the different network technologies, of course, we have also different kinds of topologies. So within the home, for example, in the Wi-Fi networks, we have some kind of a simple technology, let's say a one-hop technology, network topology, sorry, where devices are directly connected they are directly connected to our Wi-Fi router, our local box, and through that they are immediately connected to the internet. Most of the times these devices also have an IP address, if not all the times. Okay, maybe they are behind the NAT service, but they have an IPv4 address, and surely they, in new services, for example, in FastWeb, they also have an IPv6 address. Now, in the case of mesh networks like Zigbee, like Bluetooth mesh, where we have many devices spread out into the building, either in the smart home or in the smart farm, farm that we examined. Due to shorter transmission ranges than that of Wi-Fi, essentially we cannot assume that all the devices will be within the transmission range of our central box. So here we have to do multi-hop communication. We have to establish a mesh network in order to cover, provide coverage to all the devices, and in this way also reduce power consumption. So we can have different lamps creating a mesh network, or we could have sensors monitoring the temperature in rooms to coordinate with our heating and ventilation and air conditioning system. And then in the case of outdoor environments, we could use, for example, a mesh network in order to interconnect with all these agribots and carry out message exchange and message propagation of sensor data to the main network. And then, of course, we have star networks. Here, a typical example are the LP1s, long range, low power, wide area networks like LoRa, like Sigfox, where essentially we have base stations, gateways that are deployed throughout the area of interest, and then devices essentially form star networks by connecting to one or more of these gateways. So you see, we have different kind of technologies, and in this way we create a network of networks, and this is another way to view this thing. So we have different kind of networks, as we discussed. We have mesh technologies, we might have star technologies, and then of course these wireless networks are transmitting the data. The sensors and the actuators are transmitting the data collected via these technologies, and then at some point they reach the core parts of the internet. So we have a gateway that allows us to move to the internet. So this is, let's say, the border that brings us from the wireless parts of the networks into the internet. So we could also view this as the wireless extensions of internet. And of course here, using a border router, we are entering the core parts of the network, where essentially we have our cloud services for data storage, for data analysis, for visualization and the presentation of the values to the users. So there are these so-called four stages, where essentially data collected from the sensors are progressively moving towards the cloud. And of course, apart from the actual networking technologies, it is really important here to examine how we can transfer data. So let's say from TCP/IP, from internet, how we can create we can extend the web, we can extend the web protocol like HTTP in order to also involve data collected from the sensors. And of course here we need to keep in mind that at the web level, a powerful element that we have developed further during the past let's say decade is the concept of REST. So we have connections between different servers that are essentially stateless. They don't have any kind of long-term memory, and these short memory connections, these REST connections, as they are called, essentially are used in order to create a composition of data collected from different parts of the network. So we have a client that is interested to view a website, a simple web page like a Wikipedia page, and here of course we are connecting to a server But then this is, we are not limited to just one server. So if you examine your browser, you will realize that in fact we have different connections. Maybe we are most often, as a matter of fact, we are connecting to a kind of a content distribution network. We have a kind of an application load balancer, and then this forwards our requests to a group, a farm of servers, each server serving different elements. Like, for example, images are pulled from one server, or maybe they are pulled from different servers. We have style files, we have JavaScript files. So everything is essentially stored in different parts of the internet, and then we are pulling this together using the HTTP protocol or other protocols in order to build up and serve the content to the client. So the natural question here is how we can extend this in order to bring into the picture also data collected from the sensors. So here, for example, we have again the client, which is a doctor that wants to examine whether we are fit and whether we are following the diet provided to us, and essentially wants to pull the data from the body scale. Or we have the farmer that wants to assess the temperature where the produce is stored. So here now the server, of course, is the sensor, which is providing the value. And then we could think of a kind of an HTTP protocol where we are requesting for a specific value using a kind of a URL. Then this is somehow transmitted through the network, of course, to the server using different kind of networking technologies, and then the server responds to us by providing the value. So this is what we would like to do, right? I mean, a natural step forward. So here we might have a kind of a unique resource name, a URL for the sensor that we are looking up. That of course is unique, uniquely identifies this sensor. Considering, for example, IPv6, we have unlimited number of virtually unlimited number of addresses to uniquely identify every single sensor, and then of course this is combined into a URL where we define our protocol. We define, of course, the authority that is responsible for the sensor. Here we can also pass the actual URN of the sensor, and then what exactly we are looking. So this is a natural extension of HTTP. Since HTTP and the web have worked so well during the past 30 years, more or less, and we have managed to develop so many applications using the web protocols, it is natural to expect that we can essentially extend them in order to also build applications related to IoT. So let's have a look a bit more. Of course, we need here some kind of a DNS resolution. So here we need the DNS protocol in order to give us the address of the server that will resolve our request. Of course, here might be due to a content distribution network, due to load balancer, this could be a bit more complicated. But anyway, given that we have the address, then our HTTP protocol will use TCP and then IP in order to carry out the necessary exchange. Okay, however, going back to the fact that our sensor devices are not let's say, part of the internet, but they are an extension to the internet, and we have these first and second stages of the wireless networks in order to go into the third and the fourth stage. Remember the graph that we saw here, right? So if HTTP traffic is essentially in the internet, we need to consider what's going to happen when we cross and we move beyond the main parts of the internet into the constrained environments. Now here, for example, we have the CoAP protocol, which resembles a bit HTTP, and we have a number of different software components that can be used to translate HTTP traffic to CoAP traffic. And in this way, a request coming from a client as part of rendering an HTML page is essentially translated into CoAP so that it reaches our sensor that then responds with a value. The value is, for example, cast within a proxy server or directly sent to the client. I don't want to go into the details, but I want to essentially keep here the fact that we have some kind of essentially point-to-point connections, one-to-one connections between the client, between the different servers of the internet, and of course also to the sensors. So this is this point-to-point, one-to-one connections, of course, at the level of the web, right? At the level of the network, clearly we have different kinds of paths to realize these connections. But we have one-to-one connections that start from a specific client that wants to render a given HTML page, and then these one-to-one connections bring the data that we need. So here let's look at a third example, and this is the interesting part of the web of things, as it's being called. So considered let's say a contemporary smart parking system, where we have sensors deployed under the asphalt to monitor whether our parking spots are available or not. And then this value, the values of these sensors are transmitted to some kind of a central unit that then displays the number of slots available. And also we have the gate that is controlling access to the parking. Of course, in this way we can also bill charge for the customers that enter the park or carry out some security check. So here we have a very, very fixed deployment. We have a very, very fixed realization of this application, and the question is how we can extend this, how we can generalize it using the notions of the web in order to allow the realization of other services, not just of this smart parking. And here is where the use of HTML and HTTP comes into pictures, where essentially we have the different nodes, the different sensors that are essentially explaining whether they are servicing the availability of the parking spots. Then, of course, we have web servers that are using these values in order to provide a broader view of the parking space. We could also have displays that are using HTTP protocol to pull all these values and provide indications, not necessarily immediately outside the parking, but also at different parts of the city, so that we can be guided to the nearest place. Then we also have mobile applications and other kinds of applications, recommendation, for example, services on the route to choose to find the available parking slot, and so on and so forth. So essentially, using the web, by extending the web in order to include sensors, we can now build applications that are pulling the data from the sensors in a more generic way, and in this way decouple the connectivity, the network, from the application development, like we do on the web, and in this way create, let's say, allow us to be more flexible. So in this way, again, we have this one-to-one way of communicating and exchanging data, and we saw the client, which is our web browser, or it could be in this example the display of the display screen, or it could be the recommendation engine that wants to pull the data from specific sensors, which essentially are served by a given server. So this server is the specific parking, smart parking, that or a specific sensor. And then of course we have clients connecting to multiple servers, or a server servicing multiple clients. So this is the one-to-one information exchange paradigm, where of course we have the combination of all these different kind of connections in order to realize more complex applications that require access to more than one servers. Now, a different approach here is the so-called many-to-many information exchange paradigm. So here, there is the introduction of a central entity at conceptual level, of course, in our system, that is the so-called broker. So here we are not differentiating between client and servers. There is no longer this kind of relation, but there is a kind of a channel, a kind of a bus, a message bus, where essentially the devices are publishing their values to this channel, and then anyone interested to receive these values is, as we say, subscribing to a particular channel, and then starts receiving the value, these values. The step from one to one to many to many, of course, is the ability to decouple the exchange of information. So instead of having one application that is displaying the number of available smarting spots connecting to a client in order to pull the data, then having a centralized administration that is responsible for billing the services, again connecting to the same client, to the same source server, the same sensor, in order to examine the availability. Then have a third service, like the mobile application of the user that wants to essentially, for example, reserve a parking spot. Again, establishing yet another one-to-one connection to the server. So instead of having independent and multiple one-to-one connections, here we want to have a complete decouple of this producer and consumer, as we say them, and create this kind of many-to-many environment. So here, notice that we have different applications, so completely different devices that are publishing, they are producing data, and they are publishing, as we say, as we use this terminology, their values to the broker. And in this example, The broker is MQTT, but of course there are different kinds of brokers. And when the value, a new, let's say, value is published, we also use a topic, the so-called channel topic. And in this example, the channel topic is represented by a color. So you see here the different sensors attached to the trains, the passenger trains, or the tracks, and the airborne transportation essentially are colored with blue, and the consumer of this data, of course, subscribes to this blue topic in order to collect the data. While we have a completely different application, which is related to monitoring patients within the hospital, or while they are on transit, or using wearable devices, this application now is using completely different topics, and these topics are represented by another color. And of course, we can have servers that collect application from different topics. So here, essentially, we are by introducing this central entity, this broker, we are in a position to essentially completely open up the way that data are used and completely decouple the production of the data and how the data arrive to the broker, and then the consumption of the data, how these values are then used in order to build a higher level application. And of course, here notice that this is a two-way communication. We are not restricted, so a producer can also be a consumer of data, so we can also operate actuators, or we can transmit data to sensors in order to change, let's say, their operating parameters. And of course, there are many different examples. And as I said, the idea of having a centralized broker, it is completely at a conceptual level. There are essentially different, we have the creation of a kind of if we want to scale, of course, to large number of devices, to millions of devices that have a coverage of not just a building, or they go beyond the building. We can have intermediate service gateways and proxies, like in HTTP or in other protocols, which, however, are transparent to the way that we build and publish and subscribe and consume data. So here we are going to focus onto MQTT. MQTT is a standard initially introduced by IBM, but now is a broadly used publish subscribe system that essentially is the main goal is to be lightweight, so that it can be implemented also in resource-constrained environments, like sensors operating on batteries, or sensors connected via narrowband networks, where we don't have essentially the luxury of transmitting really large packets, and we have also unreliable connections. So we have to make sure that our messaging protocol guarantees the delivery of messages. So MQTT is specifically built for IoT applications, for telemetry, let's say, applications. And here we have the peers, as we say. This is a peer-to-peer network. We no longer use the terminology of client and server. So we have peers that are publishing the values to the broker, and then similarly we have peers that subscribe to specific topics and they get notified about the values published by the other peers of the network. So here, MQTT allows us essentially to exchange data either via TCP/IP, but also over WebSocket, so we can have clients like web browsers or mobile phones that are using a WebSocket rather than a TCP/IP connection due to different kind of requirements, like for example security requirements, connectivity requirements, and so on. So essentially, MQTT can be operated over HTTP, or it can communicate directly over TCP/IP, either of the version 4 or version 6. So here we have this so-called bi-directional communication, as we discussed earlier. We can have a peer that is publishing data to the broker, but is also subscribing to a specific topic, like for example this thing3/data, this could be a topic. So we have bi-directional communication between these two entities. But the important point here, to move one step further, is also the fact that we have asynchronous communication. So in contrast to other kinds of data exchange protocols, here there is no synchronization between the different parts, like for example the client and the server in the previous case, or between peers. So we might have here a peer, this third thing, that is publishing this blue packet to the topic thing3/data, and then the broker is essentially pushing this packet, this message to the peers 1 and 2 in a completely asynchronous way. So it's not necessary that they will receive it on the same time, synchronized. It's not necessary that one will receive it before 2. But eventually it will receive it. So here it is important to keep in mind that the roles, the peers essentially, are not restricted to either publisher or consumers. They can be both, so communication is bi-directional. And the second important element is that it is asynchronous, and this of course is really important in order to allow us to scale to large volumes of data, to large volumes of peers. So, as we said, MQTT supports and can operate directly over IPv4 and IPv6, but it can also operate over the WebSocket protocol. It can also use directly HTTPS in order to publish data over either IPv6 or IPv4, but only for publishing purposes. HTTPS is not used to deliver, to consume data. So essentially the topics are strings that have this kind of format. We are using the so-called topic level separator. This is a forward slash in order to create a hierarchy of topics. So we have as many number of levels as we need, and then of course at the end the final level. So it's completely entirely up to us to use as many levels as we want in order to structure our topics. Here topics are essentially 8-bit UTF encoded strings, and these allow us to use different kind of characters here to make them as rich as our application really needs to be. And due to this hierarchy, we have also the possibility of using two so-called multi-level wildcards. So in this example, let's say that we are monitoring different sports, different, let's say, games, matches that are happening concurrently. And then, of course, we have one level that represents the kind of game, like football. Then we have a second level that represents the league. And then we have a third level that is related to the game or to the stadium. So here we can use the hashtag as a multi-level wildcard. So when we subscribe to scores slash hashtag, then essentially we will receive all messages that are published to topics from that level and down. While if we use the plus, we are going to limit ourselves to a specific level. So there, this big 12 fan will examine all the topics that are below big 12 and not to other leagues. And of course, we have the possibility to subscribe to just a single specific topic, like in this case, the Texas fan. So this essentially provides the possibility, this hierarchy and the use of the wildcards essentially allows us a flexibility so that we can subscribe in one go to multiple topics. Okay, so let's now discuss a bit about quality of service and the reliability of message exchange. So here the messaging protocols available, like for example RabbitMQ, ActiveMQ, the Java messaging service. There are many different messaging protocols offer different kinds of quality of service levels. It could go up to 5, for example, in RabbitMQ. In MQTT, we only have 3 levels because, again, this is a lightweight protocol that is specifically targeting IoT devices. So we want to make sure that from one hand side we allow the development of applications to be reliable without necessarily writing many lines of code. So we want the system, the messaging system, to carry out certain operations for us, but on the other hand side we don't want to put a lot of strain, let's say, to the limited power devices. So the bottom, let's say, the most basic level, the so-called QoS zero, is the as a matter of fact, it does not provide any quality of service. That's why it's called zero. It is the so-called at most once delivery level, where essentially, if we have a failure, either at the peer level, so for example the sensor fails, disconnects, or somewhere through the network, so at some point a gateway fails that is transmitting the specific packet, then unfortunately the message will never be delivered. So that's why we call this at most once. So if everything works as it should, then the message will be delivered one and only one time. So it does not survive failures. On the positive side, we don't have duplication of data. So we will not have to examine our data to make sure that we don't have duplicates. So this is clearly the other side of this story. So the positive side is that we don't have to consider duplicates. Now, as you see here, more or less, the peer is publishing values to the broker. Now, the second kind of type of message exchange, and as a matter of fact, the first level of quality of service, is the so-called at least once. So here, the message will survive connection loss. So either because the peer broke down, or because the network did not manage to deliver the specific packet, we are using now specific acknowledgements, which are these publish ACK, PubACK messages that are essentially used to notify that indeed the message was delivered. However, here, because this publish acknowledgement might be lost as well, right? So we might have a failure while transmitting the acknowledgement of a message received. The peer might retransmit a message while this acknowledgement has not been received yet. So in this way, we are duplicating. We are creating duplicates of the original transmission. So now, although the message will be delivered, here now we have to make sure that while we are analyzing the data, we are looking for duplicates, and we are removing these duplicates from our data sets. So here, for example, it is really important to include the timestamp of the sensor at the point that the value was essentially generated, the sensor was queried, and also the ID of the sensor, so that then we can identify duplicates. This is, for example, a simple way to be able to do that. And then there is also a second level of quality of service, the so-called exactly once, which essentially combines the first level and goes a bit further, essentially guarantees that each message, not only it will be delivered, but it will be delivered one and only one time, so exactly one. Once. So here you see that we have the original publish, and then we have three more essentially messages that are essentially requesting to confirm that the message was published, the reply, and then the final commit of this reply. So in one sense, we are acknowledging the acknowledgement. If you want to view it like that, or if you want to view it in a different way, we have a kind of coordination and agreement between the two nodes. So clearly this is a much more complicated protocol for the delivery of the message. The semantics of exactly once are stronger, and in this way we require many more messages. So in this example, you can see that without any quality of service, at the so-called zero level, we only have one message exchanged through the network. If we want to guarantee the first level of quality of service, the at least once, then we also need to have acknowledgements. So now, for every data packet, we also have an additional control packet. And then if we want to move on to the second level of quality of service, essentially, for every data packet, we have three control packets. So you see here that we are using the network resources to guarantee certain quality of service. And clearly, this creates trade-offs between the operation of the network, between the requirements that we have on the sensors and on the actuators, on the wireless networks, versus the code that we need to write in order to be certain that we are essentially carrying out a correct data analysis. All right, so let's look into the actual payload. In fact, MQTT and in general, the messaging protocols are, as we say, agnostic to the payload. So this essentially gives us a very, very flexible delivery. Essentially every message published to the broker to a given topic or to multiple topics might have a completely different payload. So a common practice, for example, is to use the same structure for every for a single topic, but again, this is not enforced by no means by the protocol. So we can have binary data transmitted, like images collected from a camera. We can have JSON values collected from the sensors in a JSON format, which of course we know that it is very, very useful when we want to analyze it very, very fast using our programming language of choice, or it could be just plain text, or we could also essentially introduce some encoding of the content at the beginning in order to make it more general purpose. So clearly this is entirely up to us. The message is about, can be up to 256 kilobytes, but of course it can grow to much, much larger sizes. It could be even megabytes if you want that to be so big, and then of course at the network level we should expect to have a fragmentation of messages into multiple packets. So for example, in Zigbee networks we have packet sizes of about 134 bytes, so clearly messages larger than that are going to be fragmented into multiple packets. But as we see here, we can have we can publish different messages, text messages, JSON objects, XML objects, binary files through the same topic. There is absolutely no constraint on that. And then we also have some other abilities here. For example, we have the last value caching. This is the possibility when we connect with a specific ID. This is the first peer. We connect to the broker, and then we start publishing under this thing1/battery topic. So this gives us the battery level of the specific device. So we have a JSON object in this example with the value 95% of the sensor. And then we can use this specific flag, which is called retain. Now, essentially, the broker will act as a kind of a cache of the last value received. So the second time that the peer thing one will transmit the value, this value will replace the previous one. And the same way, in this example, we have a third publish of value 93, and then peer disconnects, maybe to save energy or because of a temporary network failure or because it just stopped working. So now the broker keeps this value, and when a second peer connects to the broker and subscribes to the specific topic, we have the broker responding by the value cast as if this was published at this point by the peer the above peer. So of course this is provided, serviced by the broker immediately. So this is the so-called last value, the retain option that we can use when we are publishing values, and the broker is capable of retaining the last value. Another interesting part here is the session state control. So when we subscribe to a topic, we are introducing a quality of service level. So as we saw earlier, it could be 2, 1, or 0. And similarly, when we publish, we can publish to different quality of service levels. So now we can keep the session, or we can require to clean a session if we want to, let's say, ignore the messages that have been published but they have not been received yet. So for example, if we clean the session, then from that point, let's say, and on, we start from clean slate. We don't care about previous messages published to the channel and not delivered yet, not acknowledged yet, as we discussed earlier about the first and the second level of QoS. And then we also have the last will and testament. This is the case when a device is disconnected unexpectedly. So here, upon connecting, we provide, of course, the ID of the device. And then we say that in case that we disconnect, we wish to publish this message by under the topic thing one status. So the device connects, carries out a series of publishes and subscriptions. This is completely relevant. And then when it disconnects, the broker will automatically publish a new message under the topic thing one status by to all the devices that are monitoring this, that have subscribed to this topic. So this is one more option, essentially, to cope with the fact that it is reasonable to expect that sensors will disconnect essentially for reasons out of their control. And for that reason, we want the broker to notify the peers. Now, if you want to set up an MQTT broker, here there are many options available to us. For example, you can use the Eclipse project MQTT implementation, the so-called Mosquito browser. This is an open source implementation, is very, very efficient, is very lightweight, and it is available for all kinds of operating systems. It can be easily installed. It implements the standard and essentially does not require many resources. But there are also other implementations like Cloud MQTT, which is a hosted broker that allows also to scale to clusters of brokers, so that we can span to really large number of sensors, or we can have Hive MQ that gives us the possibility to have either local or cloud-based deployments, and create really scalable deployments. MQTT is very broadly accepted today. So all major cloud providers like Amazon, like Azure, like Google are using them in order to bring sensor data, bring IoT devices into cloud environments. And essentially, with this we conclude the first part of this lecture. You saw that MQTT is really a simple protocol. You can also check out the actual definition of the protocol, the specification of the protocol. It's very short, let's say. You can check out the details of the different topics that we discussed today in order to get more details. And now we will move to the second part and see how MQTT is used by the Amazon Web Services under the so-called IoT Foundation. Okay, now let's move on to the second part of the lecture, and let's look into Amazon Web Services. This is an overview of the IoT Foundation, the so-called IoT Foundation. These are the core IoT services. And at the center of this core, we have this device gateway, which is essentially our MQTT browser. Broker, sorry. So we have devices that are publishing their messages to the broker. And here, of course, we need to authenticate the devices. It is important that the devices are properly authenticated, and this is actually something missing from basic MQTT. And clearly this is a serious issue. And then we have the so-called rules engine that allows us to inspect every single message arriving to the gateway, of course, based on different criteria, and then invoke other web services, either from within the AWS ecosystem or, of course, also outside systems. So now we have a really natural extension of the MQTT broker, so we can use the gateway, we can use the broker in order to essentially use this publish subscribe paradigm to communicate the values of the sensors to different endpoints. But we can also essentially use other means in order to integrate this data with websites and with data analysis services. And of course, we also have the API, which allows us to communicate with IoT core services externally in order to receive and transmit messages. So this is the high level overview. Let's go into some quickly into some very important elements. So the first element is the identification of the devices. Here, Amazon, but also all providers like Azure, Google, but this is also, let's say, introduced by Beehive and by Cloud MQTT and different other providers like Things Connect and so on. Sensors must be identified in order to access the services. So here we are using pre-deployed certificates. Authentication is based on pre-deployed certificates that are produced by, of course, the cloud authority. We also have the possibility to use our own authentication certificates, which essentially is very common when we are dealing with devices that are essentially used for example, in smart grids for measuring water consumption, energy consumption, where authentication are installed within the device and they are produced by the manufacturer. So here we have different authentication options. which essentially are based on TLS version 1.2. Of course, not all devices support TLS 1.2. Now we are also have version 1.3. However, 1.2 is the version used by Amazon, is required by all the devices to support this in order to communicate with Amazon, and essentially TLS 1.2 ensures security and confidentiality of data exchanged. Clearly, we can also have some proxy, some MQTT bridges that are using a different kind of TLS version, but we need to be very, very careful in order to guarantee the security of our system. Given that a device is properly identified, then we also have authorization. Here we have fine-grained access control for each device. We can specify if they have the ability to subscribe to a specific topic or to a range of topics, and similarly if they can subscribe or publish or both. So here we can allow, we can deny, depending on what exactly we want to allow a specific device to do. And this is a policy example. They are in Amazon, they are defined using JSON. So here you can see that this particular resource, this device is allowed to publish, it's allowed to connect, but it's denied in doing some additional actions. Now, the rules engine, another really important element, essentially is used in order to examine the raw data that are published essentially to the MQTT broker. So this is something that can allow us the continuous analysis of messages coming to the broker. And of course, here it is really important to understand that this might create scalability problems to our application. And since in Amazon, this essentially can scale using the vast amount of resources provided by Amazon, this translates into a really increased cost. So we need to be sure that the variety, the velocity, and the volume of the raw data are under control, because if we are in a big data scenario, then we will have high costs, we will incur really high costs. However, it is important to understand that here, in the majority of the cases, the raw data are not very useful. What we want to do, we want to analyze the data based on some kind of window, time window, or essentially carrying out some historic analysis of the values. And this is where the rules engine is really helpful. So we can save data to some kind of external storage. We can write the data to a database, or we can send out notifications, for example, when a value goes above or below a certain threshold. Of course, we can do many other things. One very interesting part here is the IoT analytics that we are going to discuss immediately after this. So here you can see an example of an SQL-like statement. So here we say that we want to examine all messages published under the IoT/test topic. And for each essentially message received, what we want to do, we want to store this topic within a specific data store, the so-called S3 bucket. So this will create a new item within our bucket for each different message, and of course then as separate files, we can have a Python, for example, Notepad, that reads the contents and then does a specific analysis. So this is a very, very simple case where essentially we don't subscribe directly to a topic. We just use a core service of AWS in order then to use the values, to use the published messages as files. But there is also the possibility of using IoT analytics. It is essentially a service developed to combine values coming from sensors and create data sets that we can then use using our favorite tools, easily open them using pandas and process them using our machine learning algorithm. So it is a system that is essentially collecting the data arriving from the devices. It can apply certain transformations. For example, we might want to remove some of the messages, convert a JSON format into another kind of format, and so on. And then we can also enrich the data by introducing additional information, and in this way create a more, let's say, an extended data set. And then this resulting packets are used to create the so-called data stores, out of which we can have much more complex analysis and use, of course, machine learning algorithms, and in general use them in any way we want. So we have four steps. We have the so-called channel that is collecting the data coming from the broker, matching specific topics and matching specific requirements, is essentially based on the rules that we saw earlier. So here we have one or more SQL-like statements that are used to create this channel, and we have data arriving from one or more topics, and we have then a pipeline, the so-called pipeline, that consumes the messages and carries out certain transformations. And then the output of the pipeline ends up into a data store. This is not exactly a database. It is a repository, a scalable repository of messages that can be queried, and then we can export data from the stores into the so-called datasets. So here we can have, let's say, periodic creation of datasets every day, every month, every week, depending on the analysis of the data we want to do. And this is a graphical representation of the process. Again, as we said, messages published from multiple peers through different topics are collected from the broker using the rules engine, and they are used to create a channel. This channel enters a processing pipeline where each message is processed message per message independently and enriched from external sources, from cloud services, like, for example, we can examine the location of the sensor and look up the weather at that particular location and time using Open Weather Map service. And the resulting enriched data is then forwarded to the data store. Now, the values from the data store can be extracted, and we thus create the so-called data sets, which of course are used in any way we want to analyze them using our tools, and in this way build advanced data analytics based on the IoT data. So you see here we have the devices that are publishing their values to the broker. We have certain consumers that are monitoring these values to provide telemetry, to build user interfaces, to easily notify the end users. But then we also have this ecosystem of cloud-based services that automate the process of storing all these messages and then making them available for further analysis. So with this, I'm done with the second part. We have completed this very, very quick presentation of the AWS IoT core. And now we are ready to move to the third part of the course, where I will present some hands-on examples, which of course you can perform on your own by using your own AWS account at your own time. So here the example that we are gonna use is based on a scenario on a logistics scenario, which is essentially something really, really common. So we want to do some kind of fleet management. And let's assume here that we have a company in Campania that is delivering mozzarella. Of course, we all love mozzarella. And this company is manufacturing mozzarella, and the trucks are used to deliver mozzarella to different stores in the area, directly, let's say, to bottegas or even to restaurants that are using them. So now we have trucks that are used to store mozzarella throughout the greater area, so that they are delivered. Now here, of course, one of the biggest challenges in the food service distribution is to make sure that we maintain a cold distribution chain. And here we have strong evidence that businesses experience a large percentage of spoilage of the product. So, for example, in some cases, they could be even 30%, which is really a lot. One third of the produce is spoiled while in transit. So it is natural to seek a solution to make sure that the problem is minimized and we can improve the overall delivery. So here, for example, we have refrigeration units turning off because the truck does not have the necessary power to operate the refrigeration units. So when, for example, we have an open door, then the refrigeration unit is using a lot of voltage. So it is very important to make sure that the doors are not left open. Or we might also experience electrical issues in the truck. So maybe something simply is not working as it should. So we should be notified. And there exactly is where the analysis of the data, by comparing, for example, different trucks, by comparing the historical values of a specific truck, by monitoring the temperature and so on, can help in dealing with the problems without necessarily changing equipment, without buying new trucks, more expensive trucks. So here, in this scenario, we will create some simple Python scripts that generate random values for these fictitious sensors. And the code is available on GitHub under this URL. So you can actually use directly the code and then focus on the parts related to setting up the Amazon cloud environment and then experimenting with the analysis of the data. So here we have the freezer door, which is in an IO switch, So it can be either on and off, either the door is open or closed. We have a second sensor which is related to the freezer temperature. This is the internal temperature of the trailer. So this is just a value with a real value. And then we also have the voltage that is used by the freezer unit to make sure essentially that we are not starving the freezer for power. And then as a best practice, we have a time and a date stamp to make sure that we know exactly where when these problems occur. And of course, here we might also involve a GPS locator, but in this particular example, we are not using them. So this is essentially our scenario. And now we will go into to see how exactly we can collect this data at the cloud level, so that then we can analyze, we can understand if the goods are frozen at which of course is not what we want. We want to make sure that the mozzarella is delivered at a very specific temperature range. We can understand if this is essentially connected to the way that the driver is operating the door, or if it is related to the way that the truck, the engine of the truck is operating. Good. So, having said this, having introduced here the scenario, let's connect to Amazon Web Services in order to see how this can be realized. Now, just a small parenthesis. I'm not sure if all of you have an account to Amazon Web Services. I think that we didn't work together last year with AWS. This year we started working as part of the labs of the data mining course, but I'm not sure if you already have an account. So here there is a way to create the so-called student account, Educate, using the AWS Educate portal, and essentially get a set of free credits that are given to all students of Sapienza University, and then also get some additional per class credits. So the registration process is streamlined. Here you need to use your Sapienza email in order to be verified properly. You will receive an email as soon as your application is verified. This is essentially automatic. Within a few seconds you will receive the email, and then after logging in into the Amazon AWS Educate portal, you get access to many resources related to tutorials and other student forums, and then through the Educate portal you can access the AWS main portal and get the credits that you are entitled. So the URL is awseducate.com, and here you click on the Join AWS Educate button, and then you should select the student category, which will take you to the second step where we need to complete all the fields. Here it is important that you mention as a school or institute name field Sapienza University of Rome, and then the rest of course are your information. This is your country, and this is the expected graduation month. There is no essentially, clearly this is an indication. You don't have to declare from now when you are graduated. The promo code should be left clear. And then you have to agree on the terms and condition. Many of the parts are generic, but anyway, it is important to give a look through this document, and then as soon as you agree, you submit your application, and then shortly after that, you get an email. So you are confirmed, you get an email. The email is really, really simple. You get a link, you click on the link, and then this link validates your email. And now you will have to wait a bit for your application to be validated. Again, given that you are using your Sapienza email, and given that you are using your you state that you are under the Sapienza University of Rome, this essentially is automatic. So after a few seconds, you will receive the welcome email. Make sure that the email does not end up into the spam folder. This is very common. And within this email, you will get your activation link in order to access the portal, and of course some additional information. So then you go back to your portal where you have to set your password after your first sign in. Make sure that here you have something reasonable of reasonable security. And essentially that's it. Now you have access to the Educate portal through the different resources, job postings and so on. And then on the top right, you get this AWS account link. And through that, you will be able to connect to the AWS portal in order to access all the AWS cloud services. So here you have to press this create starter account the first time that you go through this process. This is not going to be the case from the first after the first access, and this will create properly your account so that you can access the AWS console, and this will give you the $100 credit annually, and then on top of that you can receive additional credit from different courses and laboratories, which you can actually do that later on. Good. So with this, let's move on now to the practical part. So here you will end up to the AWS management console. There are many things that are of course very important. I'm not going to go into the details. I will focus here on this particular part where you look for services. There are many services provided by Amazon. So browsing the services, for example, if you click here on the top left, you get all the different services. And you see that there are really, really many services. It doesn't make sense to check them out. We just type IoT, and then we want the IoT core services. Or from the main, again, page, we have the IoT core. This will take us to the console of the AWS core. And here it is important to keep in mind that Amazon has different availability zones, as they are called. So by default, probably you are located somewhere in the United States. Probably it's better if you use an availability zone here in Europe. For example, Frankfurt, the central one, may be the most close to us from Rome. Amazon has introduced a few weeks ago another availability in Milan, which is of course much more closer, much more fast for us, but unfortunately the IoT core services are not available yet. So maybe Frankfurt is the best choice. So now We want to go through the so-called onboarding service in order to introduce our virtual track. Okay, so it is important to onboard the devices. We are going to use just one device now, but clearly this has to be done for all the devices. So this is a kind of a wizard that helps us go through the tests, the three steps to understand what's happening. So the first step is to register the thing, the physical device. Of course, in this example, it's a virtual one. Then we get the security credentials for this device in order to be properly identified. And in this, through this wizard, we also get the SDKs for our operating system, for Linux, for macOS or Windows. And then we get also some simple test scripts in Python to make sure that everything is working properly. Okay, so let's get started. So here I will choose Linux and Python. This is what I'm using. You see here that Python, we need to make sure that Python and Git are installed, and then that we have the possibility to open a TCP connection to port 8883. This is the port used by Amazon for the MQTT broker that is used. MQTT broker is also operating at port 1883 when it is not secured. As we said, Amazon does not allow unsecured connections, so only port 8883 is used. Okay, so let's move to the next part, where essentially we want to register a thing. Let's call this trunk 1. So this is a name that we are using at the cloud level. It can be made known to the device or no. This is completely different. There are also some options here that are not needed right now, but of course, if you are interested in exploring in more details, you can check them out. So now, the new thing, as the IoT is calling them, AWS IoT is calling them, has been properly created. This is the name. We also have a default policy. We can also preview this. So you see that this object is allowed to publish and receive acknowledgement under these topics. So and it's also allowed to subscribe to specific topics, and we are also allowing it to connect using different again topics. And then we also have the certificates. Now this is very important to download and keep the certificates, because there is no way to retrieve them once they have been created. So here we are gonna download them, and we are also going to download the Python SDK and also a simple script that will send and receive test messages. So just click on this, and then you are gonna download the connect device package. Okay, so this is very short. Let's go to the downloads folder, and here I will create an IoT folder, and I will move this into the IoT folder. And now I'm gonna unzip the contents of the package. So you see we have the private key, the public key, and the certificate. These are necessary for the device to identify. And then we have the start script that is going to check If we have the root certificate for AWS, if not, it will download it. It will check if we have the device SDK for Python. If not, it will download it, and then it will just create using Python a basic pub sub by using this Frankfurt endpoint, using the root certificate for Amazon, and then using the certificate of the specific device that we created and the private key. More or less, the public key is not needed, but anyway, we have downloaded it. So I will now change the instructions. And as a matter of fact, if we press here next step, we get here detailed instructions on what to do. So unzip, then we change permissions to the script, and then we execute the script, and then you see that it downloads and starts publishing messages. So this is the message that is being published. It is a message in JSON format with two fields, the message field and the sequence, and this is the values arriving. And then similarly, we can also transmit hi from the cloud, and this value will be sent to the device. So yes, this is a very, very simple script, or good. So we are done by registering the new device. We have set up the device using a certificate and the policy, and then we also done a simple test. So now when we go back to our IoT console, we see that we have the new track device trunk one register. Okay, it's also wrong. It should be track, but anyway, let's call it trunk now. And then now let's move on with the next part of our virtual sensors. So here, if you go to the URL I provided, you have under GitHub two implementations. One implementation is using the native SDK of AWS, and the other one is using a generic MQTT client based on, in fact, on the Eclipse Pajo library. So essentially, we can connect using any kind of MQTT implementation, given that it is following the standard. And then we have, let's use the AWS SDK version. You can see here, essentially, initially the connection, we are creating a new client, we are connecting to the specific port, and then we are using the credentials in order to identify ourselves and authenticate. Then we are passing some basic parameters like 5 seconds timeout for the MQTT operations, like 10 seconds timeout in order to disconnect, and so on. And then essentially we are going into a continuous loop where we are generating some random values. We are converting these values into a JSON object, and then we are publishing this JSON object to the specific topic at IoT, AWS IoT. And this is under the sensor PI file, essentially the random values. So you see we have temperature, voltage, and door. On the door is on off. The voltage is around 24 volts, and the temperature is between around minus 7 degrees. Then we also introduce a timestamp. and also the ID of the sensor. So this is the virtual sensor. Let's give it a try. So now I will go into the directory where I'm storing this GitHub repository. Here it is. I'm gonna copy my credentials. So I need the credentials here. I also need my root certificate. And now I will start Python with the pub SDK implementation. And now I will provide the necessary parameters like the root CA, which is this, the certificate, which is this one, and then the private key, which is this one, and then the client ID, it's trunk one, and then the topic that we want to publish value. Okay, so here we are gonna use the topic test one. I think this is it. Let's double check. So let's go back. We go to trunk one, as we named it. We go to security. Then we choose the specific certificate that we have created for this device. Then we go under policies. We check out this policy. And here you can see that it is allowed to publish under topic slash topic underscore one. Okay, so let's change this topic underscore one. Okay, so this now we'll I don't need this window anymore. Okay, neither this one. Let's stop it. Okay, so I will I'm missing something here. It is endpoint. I also need the endpoint. Okay. So let's go and find the endpoint. So from the core part, we can go under test, and here now we can subscribe to the specific. Okay, so no, I'm a bit confused. I'm trying to find the endpoint. So the endpoint is under settings. Here is our endpoint. Okay, so this is under Amazon, under the Frankfurt availability zone, and this is the unique name for our broker. Okay, so this, I need all of it, actually. So this is the complete endpoint. So now, the Python script will connect to this endpoint. This is our broker. And we'll use these credentials to connect, and then it will start publishing the values to the specific topic. Okay, so now we are getting some errors due to the authorization. Let's go and fix this in a bit straightforward way. So let's go slowly back to manage things. Here we are going to get the trunk. These are the details of our object. We will go to security. This is the certificates. Only one has been issued to the specific device. And then go under policies. And here let's edit this policy and make it a bit more straight and easy. So we will allow all the services for all resources, not only for these specific ones, and this essentially will be our policy. We will allow access to all IoT services and all resources. great. So now we should be able to connect and now we have a different error because essentially it is using Python 3, and now we can connect as you can see, and we can start we will start publishing values. So the sensor is publishing every 5 seconds. You see this is the JSON object. We have the sensor ID, the temperature, the voltage, the door, and then the timestamp. And we can check out these values by going to this test part, where here we can type the topic that we want to monitor. And now we will start receiving the values, as you can see, from the virtual sensor. So now we are essentially to the position where values from the sensors are arriving to the broker hosted by IoT Core. We have we changed the policy so that we can accept messages. Maybe that was not necessary, but anyway, I did it to make things simpler. And now we want we have all the messages in our MQTT broker arriving, as you can see. And of course, someone can subscribe. We subscribed essentially using this simple web page to this topic, and we are receiving these messages as they come from the device. Okay, so now let's see how we can use these values in order to analyze them. And now we are going to use the IoT analytics. So how we will see how we can direct the MQTT messages to AWS IoT analytics. So this is done using the rule, the rules engine, that will essentially forward the data. This rule that we will create will direct the data towards the IoT analytics. So the first thing we want to do is to create a rule. This is under the Act here button. We don't have any rules yet, so we need to create a rule. So we need a name. Let's call it here track. Okay, I will keep the same name as before. Since I made a mistake, let's be consistent. Let's call it this. Okay, let's call it trunk rule, trunk analyze. Why not? Simple forward of messages to IoT analytics. Okay, and now here you see we get this SQL statement. So essentially we want topic, all the messages coming from topic underscore topic one. This is the one we've been using to be forwarded. However, we can also specify certain values. So here we could say, for example, where temperature is bigger than minus 12, as an example. So we can also filter our messages. Remember that here the JSON field was called temperature. So here we, inside this SQL-like statement, we can use the names of these JSON fields directly as if they were columns of our database. So this is very, very handy when messages are in SQL format. So of course, maybe we don't need it for the example. Let's remove this. Let's just keep all the messages. So now we will create an action. Given that each message comes, we want to forward this to the IoT analytics. So send a message to AI analytics. This is the rule that we want to create, and that's it. We want to do something further. We just press configure action. So this now moves to the next action. We want here to configure essentially the way that the message is going to be handled. Remember that here we need to create the channel, the pipeline, and the data store. We haven't anything set up yet, so let's choose quick create an IoT analytics channel. So let's call it trunk here, channel, and then we just press on the quick create. So this will create a simple channel that will collect the values, a corresponding data store where the values are moved. The pipeline is very simple, and then also the generation of dataset. So let's add this action, and essentially we have the wizard ready to create the rule. Of course, we can add multiple actions here if we want. That's okay for now. So we have successfully created the rule, and here is the details of the rule. Of course, we can modify them also later on. Okay, so now we are done with the setup of the IoT core. Let's now, we don't need this anymore. Let me remove it, and I will now switch to IoT analytics in order to examine exactly what is the situation there. So now we switched to the console of from IoT core to IoT analytics. Here we can check out under the channels. You see we have our trunk channel, which is active. It was created and last updated, and then we can click on it in order to get some information. And here you can see the incoming messages for the last hour and so on. Okay, so if we go and hit there the refresh button, we are gonna see that. New messages are arriving. Let's wait a bit. So again, as we said, messages are generated every 10 seconds. So here's the new one. If we refresh, after a while we're gonna get, okay, here you see, incoming messages 18. So essentially messages are arriving, and we get here this indication, and now we have a bit more. Okay, so indeed the messages are arriving to our channel, and now let's go further down. We have, as we said, the pipeline, where the pipeline is examining every message arriving to the specific channel, and then we want to store the values to a specific store, and here we also have the ability to carry out certain actions. Here you see under activities we can create different kinds of actions depending on the value. So you see that automatically the pipeline has detected the fields of the JSON object, and in this way we can carry out specific checks, for example looking for an attribute, again examining resources, and so on. So Now here we don't want to do something like that. We just want to collect all the information. So let's select all the attributes and then we hit next. Here we want to add an activity. You can see we can remove attributes, add attributes, calculate message attributes, transform, enrich, and so on. We just want to select them. So this is the incoming message, and this is the outgoing message, and this is essentially what we want to do. Of course, we can have additional activities. We can carry out extra operations, not just this one. And now I want to save, and we get an error that yes, of course, we have not selected the include. We need to include all this also to the resulting message. So this is the pipeline, and we are also given the possibility, given the new pipeline, to reprocess messages received from previous, let's say, days and so on. So here, of course, since we have started this very shortly, we don't have a history, so we will reprocess the pipeline based on the values received so far, and essentially you will see that we have the execution count of the pipeline. So this is the pipeline now is ready. So we have a channel with incoming messages. We are transferring these messages to our data store, and this is our data store where essentially right now we are receiving these values. Okay, so given that we have this data store, now we can create a data set. This data set essentially, again, can select specific values from our store. We have again this SQL-like statement to select the specific items. We have also the possibility to schedule the generation of the data set periodically, every few minutes, hourly, and so on. And then, of course, we want to check how often this data set needs to be, let's say, the historic values of the data sets need to be stored. So now we can execute the data set immediately, run now. You have started the query of the data set. You see now this is under creating and succeeded. We have created our first data set, and you see this result preview gives us a list of the values. So that's it. And now, of course, that we have succeeded, we can also download the data set, or we can view this in different use it in different services, as we are going to do shortly. We also get the possibility to upload our Jupyter notebook within IoT Analytics, where essentially we can use specific functions to automatically access the data set without the need to download them and essentially carry out some visualizations from within the console. But we are not going to do that now. So going back to the data set, if you go under content, you will see now that we have the first execution which succeeded, and we can actually download this. It is in a COPPA separated format, the dataset. So this is the dataset that we have just created, and in this way you see one by one all the messages have been included into this dataset. And of course, if we execute one more time the dataset right now, we will have a new dataset available to us under the new date. And of course, here we will have more values given that it has been executed. So you see here we have 85 values. So this essentially concludes this hands-on example. Of course, there are many other possibilities that you can use. We saw how devices can use the MQTT protocol in order to publish their values to the MQTT broker. We are using Amazon IoT services to identify the devices and authenticate them, and then authorize them to publish values to the specific topic. Then we have created a rule that essentially picks up every message arriving to the broker under the specific topic, and then posting it to the IoT analytics service, where essentially these values are automatically collected. There we can also enrich them packet by packet using the pipeline, and then at the end create a data set, which of course the data set can be used for further analysis, either using some IoT AWS service or using a completely separate tool. So that's it. Actually, with this we conclude the lecture. I will be happy to discuss with you any kind of question or suggestion or issue you want to discuss. And once again, thank you for listening. Bye-bye.